Hi, my name is Ella and I'm the Plants Meow and welcome to my channel. So today I'm going to be doing a video about how not to kill your Anthurium Warraquianum. So Anthurium Warraquianum is a plant that I'm absolutely obsessed with. And I take absolute pride in caring for my queens and I want to be able to share the knowledge that I've learned with you. Especially since I think out of every question I get the most of, it's usually about a queen Anthurium. But to start with, I do want to give a brief little background into our queen. So she was actually discovered by a German botanist and plant collector named Gustav Wallace. In 1870, he was employed by James Veitch and Sons, and in 1872, he was sent to Colombia in order to explore. And in 1874, he actually came back with many findings, including Anthurium veitchii and Anthurium warraquianum. So while these specimens were discovered in Colombia, a lot of times you'll see in texts that they refer to it as New Granada because Thomas More actually, when he describes, Because Thomas More, when he described the species, actually inaccurately called it New Granada. So back in the day, New Granada consisted of Colombia, Venezuela, and Ecuador. And this was actually dissolved in 1821. So when Gustav actually went to Colombia in 1874, it was actually referred to as the United States of Colombia and hadn't been called New Granada for quite some time. And you'll notice actually Thomas More is associated with Anthurium warraquianum because he actually described the species in a pictorial magazine called The Florist and Pomeologist. And this is basically a magazine where James Veitch and Son in 1878 gave drawings and information about these plants to Thomas More, who then wrote about it in his magazine. And also, fun fact, but the Anthurium warraquianum was actually dedicated to a Belgian horticulturist, M. Warrock. Now, that was just a little bit of history about our queen, but before I really get into the heart of this video, which is how to care for your queen, I wanted to mention a few things. So one thing, throughout this video, I will be referencing the exotic plant manual just as a little bit of fun. So every once in a while, I will throw up a picture of the queen from the textbook and look at basically what they say in their book, how they properly care for the queen Anthurium, and if it matches up to basically what I say. So additionally, I also will be answering your questions. On Instagram, I did make a post about how I wanted people to ask me any questions they had about the queen, or even to tell me any kind of beliefs they have that I can either confirm or dispel. So I actually have a few to begin with. So the first one is, wish I had a queen Anthurium so I could ask a question. Where there's a will, there is a way, and one day. They ask, can they survive in house conditions? How? Please help. So this video is all about Anthurium warraquianum surviving in household conditions. I'm not gonna be talking about how to take care of her in a greenhouse, this is specifically having her as an indoor houseplant. I've heard that it's a difficult plant that needs extra care. Is this actually true? It's really difficult. I probably would kill it. Are queen Anthuriums harder than other Anthuriums? Honestly, a lot of people say this, how difficult queen Anthuriums are. I'll basically explain in this video why she's not harder than other Anthuriums, and that's kind of just this perpetuated thing that's going around. And what how I feel about this Anthurium is this last one here. So she says, myth, queens being the hardest Anthurium, in my opinion, one of the easier. And I think that as well. And I will tell you exactly why I think that in this video, because there's certain things about her that do make her easier than other Anthuriums, but there's also certain things about her that if you're not aware of, will definitely make them harder. But hopefully through watching this video, you'll gain more of an understanding of her and how to take care of her without feeling like she's just gonna combust on you. So just a little bit of background on our queens, and this is very important to her care. So our queen Anthurium is an epiphyte, and she grows along the trees in the wet forests of the Pacific lowlands and the intermountain valleys of central and western Colombia. She can actually grow up to 6 feet tall, and the larger her leaves get, the more pronounced these silver veins will get on her foliage. And one of the reasons I have so many queens is that they are a highly variable species, meaning they can be narrow to wide, to light, to dark, and then there's just a lot of different ones out there. And this doesn't just go for your queen Anthurium, but it really goes for all other Anthuriums because they as a genus are just so very different, which is why you'll often see a lot of natural variations between species. So that's why one regale won't look like another regale, why one queen won't look like another queen. There's just so many factors that go into their appearance. So I care for my queen anthurium the way I do for all of my anthuriums. But there are certain things that are very important to know before your anthurium is acclimated into her new environment. And a lot of factors will play a part in how well she does when she first arrives. So we'll do a little bit of story time really quickly. When I first purchased Anastasia here, I was new to anthuriums. So when I got her, she had 3 beautiful leaves, and I was so excited to collect them that I just didn't do my research like I should have. I had a few other anthuriums at the time. They were doing perfectly fine, so I thought very nervously because I knew it would be a challenge that I'm gonna try my hand at the queen. And really the only thing I thought would be an issue is humidity, because that's kind of all you hear when you think of the queen. Oh, what's wrong with her? Humidity. What's wrong with her now? Humidity. Okay, everyone seems to blame humidity as the issue, when honestly, humidity, I'm gonna tell you right now, is not always the problem. It just kind of drives me bonkers how everyone's always blaming and humidity problems for anthuriums. In my opinion, high humidity can actually mask actual issues your anthurium's having and you won't realize it. So it's really important to consider what else could be wrong with your anthurium. But with Anastasia here, I essentially put her in a mix that was way too dense. So at the time I had used a lot of coquecoir. And coquecoir to me is basically like a soil. It holds a lot of moisture. So I had coquecoir, I had chunks of coir, perlite, some stalite, but the ratio was very much off. So way too much coir. She did not like that, and she started gradually getting yellower and yellower. So while she wasn't my first anthurium, she was the first one who actually really cared when something was wrong. So the reason people think she's difficult is because she doesn't tolerate when something is wrong, right? Honestly, that's not really being a diva, because it's not really fair. Your other anthuriums are just tolerating what they're in, right? So she's telling you like, okay, I'm not gonna tolerate this. Like, and she shouldn't. I put her in too dense of a soil. That was my mistake. It's not on her. So now I'm gonna just briefly go over soil composition and what I use now that all of my anthuriums are in that they absolutely love. Now, in this clip I'm gonna show you, I'm not gonna be measuring my soil. If you wanna see me measure it, you can go watch my anthurium care video where I do show the measurements. But honestly, for the most part, when I make their soil, I kind of just throw it into a big bowl. I don't really measure because it's just, I have a lot of anthuriums. I don't have time to measure them exactly. And I feel like I have a good eye for how much of I need of each thing. So first I like to add bark into the mix because as an epiphyte, she likes to attach to bark. So to me, it seems natural to try to replicate her natural environment. Additionally, we have to consider that she's going to be indoors and in a pot. Thus, we need to add other things in our composition to account for a change in environment. I add a little soil just to use as a wetting agent because I do not want to water my anthuriums every day. Please keep in mind that the amount of soil is not a lot. I believe my mix uses about a tenth of soil in the mix. Too much soil will be detrimental for your anthurium. I add charcoal because it helps guard your soil from bacteria, fungus, and rot, and it helps to eliminate odors and absorb excess water from the roots. I add perlite because it adds a lot of air into the mix, but it's also able to retain some moisture in the little crevices on the sides of perlite. I add tree fern fiber because it is well draining and provides good airflow. It also prevents compaction, which is why I choose it over adding sphagnum moss into my soil. Also, it has excellent water retention capabilities, which is good for keeping your anthurium moist. I have heard you could actually grow your anthurium straight in tree fern, but personally, that would be pretty expensive. So everything I add into my mix has been well thought out. It's something that I feel like she'll actually really enjoy, and it's something they've seemed to be thriving in. So if you look at the mix that Anastasia's in now, it's so very airy. And you can really probably not even notice the soil in there when you look down into that. You mostly just notice the tree fern. The soil is just so sprinkled throughout. It's just hardly a noticeable thing. It's really just there so I can get away with waiting to water my anthuriums just for a few days. But the worst thing you could do is leave your anthurium in a dense soil. You want them to have as much air as possible. You can actually not even put soil into your mix and they'll be perfectly fine. So if we actually look at the exotic plant manuals, you'll notice on the picture that the chart actually says that she should be in humusy soil, which consists of peat moss, leaf mold, and fibers. So this is really similar to what we have. I occasionally use peat moss instead of soil, but for the most part, I use my moisture control Miracle-Gro, and honestly, I have zero problems with that. Straight peat moss, in my opinion, is way too dusty. I just don't like it. I actually have zero problems having them in it, and also it's cheap. So I spend a lot on all the other ingredients for my queen. It's nice to have one thing that's barely in the mix that is a cheap thing. So I have zero problems with using that. You don't have to. I know a lot of people are against Miracle-Gro. I feel comfortable using it because there's a lot of botanical gardens like the Missouri Botanical Gardens and Steve Lucas of the Exotic Rainforest that also use Miracle-Gro. So I'm totally cool with it if they are. But simply put, it's really up to you. You don't have to use it. I'm not even advocating to use specifically that. So, yeah. All right, time for some questions. Mine nearly died on aeroid mix. It loves sphagnum moss. Is it the best substrate for that plant? Regular aeroid mixes I don't use for my anthuriums because honestly, they just contain way too much of a soil ratio, specifically for the queen. Specifically for the queen anthurium, you really don't want that much soil in there. It was probably just too heavy or it wasn't getting enough air depending on the container it was in. But a normal well-draining mix is great for your anthurium or queenum. But that doesn't mean moss is a bad choice. You can grow your anthuriums in moss and that's perfectly fine. If she's thriving in moss, just keep her in moss. Like, there's no reason to change her out of there. I wouldn't say it's the best substrate for your queens because it's not like they're growing in piles of moss in the wild. But if she loves that in your home, then that's going to be the best one for your queen at the time. I personally don't have any of my anthuriums growing in moss, except for one that was recently shipped to me. So I'm just not a big advocate of moss. But if it works for you, just keep doing it. So the next question, I got an unrooted anthurium in moss, but it's been 3 months and still no root. So honestly, moss to the propagation doesn't work well for me. I know it does for other people, but if it's been 3 months and you still don't have a root, I would just suggest changing out substrates. Put in a pot of perlite and put that pot into a saucer of water and just kind of try to root her from there. I have a video about perlite propagation and it works really well for me. So I would definitely try that. But 3 months into root, that's too long. But also make sure that you are still kind of like feeding your anthurium. Just because you're propagating it doesn't mean that it doesn't need any kind of nutrients. So make sure you're supplementing it with some kind of feed. It might just not be able to photosynthesize properly without proper nutrients. Sphagnum moss around the stem, yes or no? So this is one that it can go both ways. So I don't use sphagnum moss around my stems because the one claim to fame sphagnum moss around stems has is that it'll raise the humidity around your plant. And in my plant room, I have a fan running 24/7. And that moss, I've tried it before, would dry out even like the hour or two. So it just felt pointless to me. And I wasn't going to be misting all of my anthuriums every day. And that scent just seemed crazy to me. But reasons you would want to put it on your stems were things like, or if you want roots to start growing out of the stems, then that's a great way to do that. Also, it's a good source of support. So if you want to support your stem because it's getting like really lanky and tall, putting moss around it is a great way to support her. And if you actually wanted to propagate your plant, this is certainly a great way to do that because if you are encouraging those roots, you can always take a top cutting from that. All right, so the next thing I did wrong with Anastasia here was that I put her in moss without proper airflow. So at that time, my soil substrate was so dense, I was like, everyone's using moss. It seems like the saving grace of the anthurium world. So many people are using it. That must be what she wants, right? So I had a glass IKEA cabinet I was keeping her in. The humidity stayed, I think, around 70% in that IKEA cabinet. And I would open it a few times a day to let my ceiling fan air it out. But that was just not enough airflow. And eventually I noticed she was still declining. If you're going to use an enclosed cabinet, please make sure you put a fan in there. I did that at a later date for other plants that I had in my IKEA cabinet. I just had a little fan in both of them. And it worked really well for them after that, but I wish I had thought to do that sooner. At the time, I just didn't realize how important airflow was to anthuriums. So when I realized she was still declining, I took her out of moss, noticed that there was definitely mold in the moss. So I sterilized her and put her in a new mix, which I thought was great. So at this point, she's been repotted for the third time. And then actually some months later, I spoke to an expert hybridizer and we talked about proper soil mixes. And I actually decided to modify my mix again. So at that time I had made the decision to pot all of my anthuriums in net pot with my brand new mix. So she was repotted for the fourth time. So I've had no issues with her since that fourth time of repotting, but let me tell you, she does hold a grudge. So I think 7 months after I had repotted her for the final time, she put out a new leaf. So that leaf, it's actually in the back over here, but she put out that leaf in January. And then just this past month, she has put out this leaf here. So she's finally growing pretty steady now, and I'm really happy about that. Unfortunately, she has lost all her prior leaves, but that's just really my fault though. But moral of the story, air circulation is vital to anthuriums. So they're very prone to bacterial and fungal infections, so a fan is gonna be so important. And also by providing them with net pots, I have given them additional airflow to their roots. And if you decide to do this, don't be surprised if your roots start growing out of your net pot really pretty quickly, because there's so much oxygen going to their roots and they're basically super happy. So they just throw out a crazy amount of roots. And it doesn't mean you need to repot them right away, because it's probably just gonna happen again if you do it again. So it won't hurt you to wait a while if that does happen. So now I wanna talk about everyone's biggest thing, and that's humidity. So in nature, their humidity can get crazy high sometimes, and it makes sense to replicate that, right? Well, there's a few things that you're gonna have to consider. One is they have crazy high humidity because they're able to remedy that high humidity with extreme airflow. The amount of airflow you're gonna be able to give your queen indoors will never amount to the airflow she can gain outside in the great outdoors. You won't be able to replicate the planet Earth airflow, is what I'm saying. So by replicating that humidity, that can introduce certain problems into not only your household, but your queen. So you're really doing a disservice to both of those things if you put the humidity extremely high. So with me in my plant room, I give them about 55 to 60% humidity, which isn't the normal high humidity we all hear. We always hear that she needs 70%, 80%, 90% humidity. But what you have to think about is that there's a reason she needs high humidity, and that's because of moisture. So high humidity plants keep a lot of moisture in their leaves. So that means in drier situations, they're gonna be transpiring at a faster rate. So what that means is you can compensate in the situation by just watering them more frequently. So I water mine about every 3 to 4 days and keep them in that 55% humidity. And as you can see here, they're perfectly fine with that. I'm not saying not keep her in high humidity, because you can, certainly you can. Just make sure you're able to balance that. What you have to keep in mind when you try to mimic her natural habitat is this. This isn't her natural habitat. Compromises have to be made for the good of your plants and the good of your space. All right, now for some lovely questions. I got so many humidity questions, and I'm sorry if I don't get to every question that you guys have asked, but there was a lot here, and I really, really love that you all participated so much. Thank you for that. So there's a ton of beliefs out there that say she absolutely needs very high humidity, that they'll die without it, they aren't forgiving, they can't live without it, they will be crispy, they won't stay looking nice. So there's just a lot of things out there, and like I've discussed, it's perfectly possible to keep your anthuriums in moderate humidity. An indoor space is not the same thing as an outdoor space. So plants grow very differently indoors. And it's really all about a balancing act. And as long as you're able to kind of figure out what they need in order to kind of compensate, then you'll have a lot of success growing plants. So this question is it possible to own one without a humidifier? And to that, I would say it depends on what your humidity is indoors. If you can keep your humidity at 55%, then I would say you don't need a humidifier. But if it drops below that, I certainly would suggest getting one. I wouldn't point the humidifier directly on top of them just because it can create bacterial issues in an indoor space, but maybe to the side of them or just around them. That way the humidity stays high around them, but they're not constantly staying wet. Keeping your anthurium leaves constantly wet will lead to issues with bacteria. Does using humidifiers somehow make their leaves soft or melt them? So honestly, this is a combination of things. It's not just humidity, but it's also the heat you have your anthurium in. So if your anthurium is in a really warm place, like your queen in general does not like temperatures like in the 90s and above. She really prefers that 70 to 80 degree range, which is why even Enid at NSC Tropicals was struggling with her queens for so long. Now she has them on a grow wall where it stays a little bit cooler in her shade house. So the queens are much happier there. But yeah, heat will definitely melt your queens. And certainly having the humidifiers blasting on top of them, like having them stay wet all the time, can have them go soft. Which I know this is probably confusing people because people always think their leaves should remain moist, right? That makes sense. But again, they aren't outside. They aren't in an outdoor greenhouse. Like, there's just a lot of factors that you have to think about. Like, if you're not replicating all factors, then you can't expect to do it, one of them indoors, and expect it to be extremely successful. So you really have to think about what could happen if you replicate a certain factor, but you aren't thinking about all of them. So also they say, I have my queens with humidifiers, but people are telling me that I should acclimate them outside instead. Now, honestly, if you live in a tropical area, if you want to do that, that's fine. You don't have to put them outside. Like, you don't have to listen to people that are saying keep your queens outside. But if you want to do that, you can. If you don't have the climate for it, then absolutely don't do it. But if you definitely have the climate for it, that's something definitely to consider. But it's perfectly fine to keep them inside. I haven't had any real issues with them. And that really goes into this last question here, which brings me to the next thing I'm going to be talking about. So PDX Planty Things says, some people say they need a lot of humidity, but I've seen other people have beautiful queens with average humidity. Of course, temp matters too. Wondering if it just needs to be acclimated to less humidity and then it's okay. And to that I say, that is exactly it. It's really all about acclimation. So the only time I say that the humidity requirement would change like at a 55% to like I would recommend way higher is when they're acclimating. You have to think about the environment that your queen is actually coming from. So when you first receive a queen, she's oftentimes imported or she's coming from some tropical place like Florida, and she's used to constant moisture, and traveling is very drying and stressful. And if she's coming to a place with way less humidity, as soon as you open her out of that package where she was safely contained, she's gonna be transpiring at a crazy fast rate, and this can be very traumatic. This is oftentimes when people have their issues with their queens, because it's just a really stressful time for your queen anthurium. And like I said, she's not shy on letting you know when something's wrong. This thing has been running around the house like a crazy person. So when you first get your queen, I suggest putting her near a humidifier or putting her in an indoor greenhouse. So there's gonna be so many things that she's getting used to when you first get her, including temperature, watering schedule, the type of water you use, altitude, light, so many things. So in this super stressed state, you need to make sure her most important need is taken care of, which is moisture. So some people have no issues with their queens and put them directly into a moderate humidity environment like mine. And that's probably because they've come from similar environments. Or they could have been shipped at a time of year when there's more moisture in the air. Or they just happen to get a strong plant. By that I mean that with anthurium seedlings, you're gonna get an array of plants. Some plants are just gonna be stronger and more viable than other seedlings. So besides viability, their foliage can look different and their rate of growth can also be different. And those that are stronger can obviously just handle a bit more. So I've actually bought quite a few queens now and I've really wanted to see if I was just getting strong plants or that I was just doing something right. Honestly, it took me a while to put out this video because I just wanted to be absolutely sure before I gave you guys any advice on queen anthuriums, because to me it's really important if I'm doing this right to get this out there so that other people can successfully grow their queens as well. I don't want any to perish. Thankfully, I do feel confident in the care that I give them. And I want to mention, don't be discouraged if your queen does drop a leaf. Sometimes it just happens. Sometimes they're just the run of the litter. Sometimes there's not a great reason for it. I've talked to quite a few like seasoned collectors that just expect all the leaves on their plants that they import to fall off. Now, personally, I try to prevent that in any way I can, but sometimes It's just gonna happen. Now, I also wanna mention with acclimation that there's no difference between a dark queen and a green queen. And what I mean by that is a difference in care. It's funny because if you look at really old forms, people will say, oh, the green queen is so much easier than the dark and fussy queen. And today, people say the dark queen is less fussy. But in the end, neither is less fussy. They're equally as fussy, if fussy at all. It's just something that kind of gets perpetuated based on if you've had a plant come and it's been successful. So some people will get, you know, a dark and a regular queen. And if one goes poorly, they'll expect the other one. That's the fussy plant, right? That's, of course it is. But there's so many factors that go into what happens when your plant first comes to you. And it's not gonna be the size of your leaf. It's not gonna be the color of your leaf. That makes no difference to whether she's gonna lose her leaves or not. It could be as simple as the soil substrate you put her in. So you gotta think about the substrate she's used to. You don't know what she's used to. If you put a queen in a denser soil substrate than she's used to, she's going to react poorly to that. She's going to tell you that, unlike other anthuriums, which may not. So it's really important to give her the as airy a substrate as you can, so she won't argue about being put into an airier substrate she's used to, but she will throw a fit if she's put into something heavier. And sometimes it's just as simple as that, and it can happen in the blink of an eye. One wrong decision, and the next day she can self-destruct. Not all anthuriums do react this way, but the queens aren't called divas for nothing. Precision is key with them, and it's easy when you know exactly what to do, when you're used to importing anthuriums. But it can seem difficult if you've never had an anthurium demand something of you. So she's not gonna, like I said, tolerate into being put into situations that she does not like, but other anthuriums may. So now I'm gonna go through and talk about their acclimation stories and just tell you how they got to the points they are now. So Anastasia here, who had all her soil issues, honestly, if it wasn't for the soil, I think she would have had zero issues, which is amazing. So Anastasia was actually imported into a cellar in New York City, and she acclimated there for a few weeks. And I believe if I just had put her in the correct soil from the first time around, that I would have had zero issues with her. She's honestly been a gem. Since then, she didn't shrivel up because of humidity issues. That wasn't an issue. She was already acclimated to the environment here in northeastern USA. So she was already used to New York City environment, so just coming to Delaware wasn't going to be a big issue for her. So honestly, it would have been a super awesome experience with my queen anthurium if I had just known about the soil substrate from the get-go. I feel like I wouldn't even have questioned whether queens were difficult if that had been the case. So that was pretty awesome. So Amara here and Lottie over here were actually imported into a cellar in Florida. So the conditions there, bit more tropical than my conditions here, and I purchased them in October, so it wasn't too cold yet. At the time, they each had one leaf, and I had made the decision to just put them straight into my 55% humidity environment. So they had already been semi-acclimated living in Florida, then they came here, and the single leaf they did have just kind of acclimated slowly a bit over a few months. So I was, yes, I lost the original leaves, but not at a quick rate or anything, so they kind of just adjusted to my 55% pretty well. Like, I didn't have any issues with that. And I believe that's mostly due to the time of the year, because as a word of caution when it comes to acclimating plants, try not to buy any anthuriums during winter. Acclimation is just that much more difficult, and precision of care will be vital during this time of year. I have made anthurium purchases during winter. I'm not talking about queens here. And they have shriveled up, and I have given them the same care that I did during the spring, summer, and fall months. It's honestly just a more traumatic time for them, and it's just gonna be that much more difficult. Personally, I don't think it's worth it financially to buy an anthurium during winter unless they're local to you, because it's been really difficult for me, even ordering them from Florida. Just all bad, all bad. So my indoor greenhouse honestly has been my saving grace this winter. So putting them in there definitely saved their lives. But I definitely don't see myself ordering any plants during winter ever again. And Helena here was actually purchased with her sister, and she was imported in October. So around the same time I got Lottie and Amara, but unlike them who were already in the US, she came directly from Ecuador. And because they came from directly from Ecuador, I put them both in my indoor greenhouse, and neither had lost any leaves or showed any signs of acclimation stress. And I actually moved Helena here about 2 months later into my 55% plant room. So she got a big drop in humidity there, but she had no issues with that. And I believe that this was due to the fact that she had already acclimated to a lot of conditions in my household. So really just changing one thing wasn't gonna be a big issue. I also increased her watering frequency to like my other plant room plants, because my greenhouse plants don't need as much water because they're not transpiring as fast. So they don't go dry as quickly. These are her two original leaves on the side here. And she actually produced this leaf here in the greenhouse. And then when I moved her into my plant room, she produced this big leaf here. So that goes to show you that just because I moved her into a lower humidity situation, it doesn't mean that's gonna stunt her growth. In fact, she still increased, so I'm having no issues with growth there. I also want to mention, while Amara and Lottie did have their initial single leaves, they did both lose those eventually because of acclimation, but it took a few months, and then they both have replaced them. Lottie has grown two leaves and is growing a third one, and Amara has grown her one leaf here. With Lottie, if you actually notice, there is a bit of damage on her leaf. That's mostly due to because her soil was a bit too heavy for too long. So I've cut back on the amount of water I give her when I do water her, and I stopped seeing a progression of that. So, which brings me to watering, is that when I water my anthuriums, I keep them moist. I pretty much just do light but frequent waterings. So I never fully like heavily water and have the water drip through and saturate, because that's just a lot of water for them. They're used to like short bursts of water. Honestly, the worst thing you can do for an anthurium is absolutely drench the soil and then wait for it to become dry. One, because drenching the soil is way too much water for them. And two, if you wait for them to dry, if they dry too long, that could potentially kill your plant. So the first thing that'll happen is that your leaves will droop. And then after that, they'll suck out all of the water from the leaves, and they'll kill the leaves in order to keep the stem alive. So just don't let your anthurium dry out completely. It's a mistake. So if we look at the exotic plant manual chart here, you'll notice they also say keep it moist, but not constantly wet, when the alternative is to drench and then allow it to become dry. So never drench, just keep moist. They are not exactly like other aeroids. You cannot keep them in the amount of soil or give them the amount of water that you would say a philodendron or a monstera at one given time. They want you to spend so much time with them, like they want you to water them all the time, but don't water them a lot. Don't give them a ton of water. So like earlier I mentioned, our queens don't like high temperatures. And what's also great is queens can actually tolerate lower temperatures, like the low 60s, and a lot of other anthuriums making temperature stress issues from that, but queens are perfectly fine in lower temps. I'm not talking about freezing or anything, but they're certainly more tolerable in temperature-wise than other anthuriums. So I think a happy medium between 70 degrees Fahrenheit and 80 degrees Fahrenheit is probably the best for them. So if we look at the chart here, they are considered warm. So 62 to 65 degrees Fahrenheit, 16, 18 degrees Celsius. And this is for their nighttime temperatures, which is pretty much what it's exactly like in my plant room. And temperature can rise to 80 or 85 degrees Fahrenheit or 27 to 30 degrees Celsius in the daytime. And this says before vents are opened. The alternative here is make sure you on top of good airflow, you also need a fan around them just to keep temperatures lower. But usually that high temp is not a problem in a household, which makes this plant easier in household in terms of temperature. She likes the temperature we have in our house, so that is definitely an added bonus when it comes to these plants. That's awesome. So the next thing I want to talk about is light, and my queens love light. So I'll have to record Anastasia here, her other leaf, but she has it very twisted because they're both facing different light sources. But yeah, they'll break their heads just to get good light. I have never had any of my other anthuriums move their guniculums as much as my queen anthuriums do. So they prefer bright indirect light, and queens definitely take the bright part to heart. And you have to think about it this way. They climb up trees in nature to reach the light. You know, they're attempting to get out of their shadowed canopy of plants. Like, they want more light, so giving them low light is generally a disservice for the plant. So if we look here at our chart, it says that she prefers shady or away from the sun, and her preference is gonna be 50 to 500 foot candles, and her tolerance is as low as 10-foot candles. I would never give her just 10-foot candles because, honestly, if you want your plant to thrive, you're really going to want to give them, like, a good amount of light because we want these plants to do really well and to photosynthesize properly. And without great light, they're not going to be able to do that. I do have a question here, and it is, what is the perfect lighting for them to ensure long leaves and keeping them dark? Honestly, I don't manipulate light to keep one anthurium darker than another one. I have all of my queens on one shelf. They receive the same amount of light, and they all vary in the shades that their leaves show. Mara here is fairly dark, like so dark. And she had like a light like right in front of her when she was growing. So to me, it's pretty crazy that she stayed dark. But Anastasia here as well, like you can tell she has definitely a different complexion than Amara does. And I'll give you close-ups of both of them so you're able to see like really good. But honestly, I wouldn't go about manipulating light conditions. If you want to ensure them being dark, keep them around 50-foot candles, but I wouldn't want to make them suffer by giving them too little light. And then next I want to talk about one of the biggest issues people have with their anthuriums. I get a lot of messages basically, and if they're not watering issues, they're usually fertilizing issues. So there's a myth going around that anthuriums don't need any fertilizer, and this goes for especially epiphytic plants. Now, all plants need nutrients in order to properly photosynthesize, and if you're not fertilizing your plants, honestly, you shouldn't own them, because people who say that fertilize their plants are gonna end up killing their plants in the long run. There's certainly a thing such as nutrient deficiency. It's a thing, it'll happen to your plant if it's not happening yet. It's a slow progression, and if it shows up to a detrimental degree, you won't be able to stop it. Also, not giving the fertilizer is like telling your kid to write an essay without teaching him how to write the alphabet. Like, it's nonsensical. They can't photosynthesize without having the tools in order to photosynthesize. And also, just not fertilizing your queen will, besides showing up as blemishes on your leaf, if your queen produces a new leaf, she'll kill her old leaf in order to suck all the nutrients out of it. So people that say that they can't keep many leaves on their anthuriums just haven't fertilized them properly, because it's perfectly possible to keep a bunch of leaves. Helena here has 4. The only reason the others don't have more is because of my stupid mistakes or acclimation, things like that. So I expect them fully to be much larger plants within the next year. And while anthuriums don't receive a high amount of nutrients from nature, they do receive them. Nature is a wonderful thing and has ways of getting plants the nutrients that they need. Whether it's an accumulation of nutrients that gets rained on your plant, bugs carrying berries, or leaf litter, there's just so many ways. In an indoor environment, you're not getting any of that. Even if you are using rainwater, it's not the same rainwater they'd be getting in their native Colombia. So you have to be able to compensate for this lack of nutrients by giving them fertilizer. I personally use Osmocote slow release fertilizer, but you could also use Nutricote. So I give them about a teaspoon per 6-inch pot and then modify it based on if they're smaller or larger. And you also want to keep in mind that your indoor soil ecosystem is severely lacking. So I would suggest adding some additional vitamins or microbes. So to achieve this, I use liquid dirt, and this was brought to my attention by my friend Amanda. I had been looking to introduce some kind of microbe into their soil for a while now, and I was super excited when she told me about this product, because it was created by the same people who created the product from Newt, but it's essentially a way more condensed and more affordable product. It's something that I can use organically on top of my slow release fertilizers, and I know I won't have any issues. So I use about 4 to 6 drops of that in a gallon of water, and I use it to water my anthuriums every time I do a watering. All right, so one of the last things I wanted to cover, support stakes. So as you'll notice here, Amara and Anastasia both have moss poles attached to them, and that's simply because their leaves are way larger, and as your queen anthurium grows and the larger her leaves get, the more heavy they get, and they're prone to toppling over and breaking. So you really want something to support them in some kind of way, whether that's adding moss around their base or adding a moss pole to them. It's something I use in order for them to attach to so they can climb up it. I want their leaves to get as big as possible. So as epiphytic plants, they're used to climbing up trees, and giving them these poles gives them the opportunity to attach to something and climb. So to me, that seems like the ideal situation for them. When I repotted Anastasia and Amara the other day, I gave them these poles. So they're not attached to them yet, But the benefit of attaching them to poles is that their roots will start growing along the poles, which is really awesome if you ever want to take cuttings. But also, why I really love these particular poles I made, and they're generally the same pole that I made in my previous how to make a moss pole video, except I modified them slightly by adding this fabric between the wire mesh and the moss. So the fabric itself is called hygrolone, and it basically mimics tree bark. So when you water it, it disperses the water evenly, and it's something that I think the queens are really gonna love, and they get the most bougie treatment because they are my queens, so I'm really excited to see how they do with this. And this product was actually recommended to me by my friend Brian Chen, and I was super excited when he recommended this because personally moss poles are kind of a pain to water, and this makes it so much easier. So I'm really happy to have this. I will eventually put out a tutorial on it. All right, before we get to the final questions, I want to go over one more section, which is the dark form. So we've already covered if the dark form is less fussy, which I say no, and whether the green form is harder to take care of or if there's actually a difference. So in terms of care, there's absolutely no difference between them. And to answer this last question, which is the dark and narrow form real, or is it just a regular queen grown under different conditions? I have all these queens, like I said, growing in the same conditions, same lighting, and they have all grown very differently. So I think this really goes back to seedlings and how different they all look. All anthuriums are highly variable. So yeah, you're gonna have some queens that are gonna be naturally darker than other queens. Sometimes they're wide and dark, sometimes they're narrow and dark. Like, there's just a big combination and so many different variations that you can have in your queen anthurium. It's not a different species, it's still the same species. It's just a highly variable one. But also you have to keep in mind that while dark forms do exist, there are dark forms that have been manipulated by sellers. So sellers that have been giving them lower light conditions in order to produce much darker leaves. So while they do exist, there also exist the manipulated forms of them. So please do keep that in mind when you are purchasing a queen anthurium, which isn't great. It's pretty deceptive, but honestly, it's just something that happens. You know, anthuriums can be pretty pricey, and it's something that happens in a market where if you want a plant to be worth more money, you make them darker. So it's just kind of sad, but all right, so now for the final questions. And I feel like I've been talking forever, so I hope this video is not like crazy long or crazy boring or anything. And I'm hoping that it's super helpful. So for the first question, how often does it put out a new leaf? So honestly, this is a highly variable thing. You can have a queen producing a leaf a month, a leaf every other month, a leaf every 3 months, honestly. It depends on their viability, how strong are they as a plant, how high is your humidity. In a very high humidity situation, you're gonna have more leaves produced on your queen. If I stuck these in my indoor greenhouse, I would expect them to produce leaves at a faster rate than they would in my plant room. So there's really not a good answer for this. It also depends on things like nutrients. How much nutrients have they got? A plant that has been fed more than another will be able to photosynthesize and produce more leaves at a faster rate. So what causes yellowing and crisp edges? So one of the things that does that is overwatering your anthurium, so giving them too much water every watering. It could also be a lack of nutrients. They will start pulling the nutrients from the edges, or it could honestly even be a lack of watering. So you have to make sure to water them frequently, and if that's not done, that can also cause this. And of course, what a lot of people gravitate to is low humidity. But honestly, I don't think this is always the number one reason for that. There's just so many ways that humidity doesn't have to be an issue if you just do other things. So when I say lack of watering, you could also say that's a humidity issue, because it's the same thing. If you just give them more water, then that would fix the problem. But if you gave them more humidity, that would also fix the problem too. So I know. What I'm saying is just water your plants, guys. But also, I want to mention here, if you notice the crisp here on this plant, on the edge here, and then over here, that isn't from any issue that I caused. This was actually a leaf that was, this was broken in shipping, and I've just never removed it. I've just left it on. Not sure, I don't know. It just never bothered me, so I just left it there. But it's not something that was caused by like a lack of humidity. Next question. How come queens are more finicky and susceptible to their leaves crisping up and such? There's such a simple answer to this, and they're not. I've had so much more trouble this past winter with other anthuriums crisping up that I've imported in than with my queen, which makes me think it's really about the circumstances where your plants are coming from that causes this to happen, because I've never had a queen wither up like that. And it's always because I knew what to do right away. Besides Anastasia, who I was lucky, she was acclimated to my environment. But yeah, they're just not more prone to that. Honestly, they're in such high demand that a lot of the times the ones people are getting have been recently imported and they haven't had time to acclimate. So they're just gonna freak out by the time they get to you. And that's honestly just like, and I feel like that's such a big issue with sellers too. Like, if you chose to have it imported from another country, then you have to know how to acclimate your plants to the environment. But sometimes you buy from a seller in the US who's recently had it imported and it hasn't acclimated. And that's something they did that's not okay. So with my plants, whenever I import them, if I ever plan on selling any, it wouldn't be for like 3 months. I know that's like long in some people's opinions, but personally, like, while I don't want any plants to fail. And a lot of the times queens get set up for failure with all these imports and them quickly getting shipped out. So it's really just not their fault. It's just something that happens to happen because of the high demand in the market. Is it completely different than an Anthurium clarinervium care-wise? I treat all my Anthuriums the same. So I personally would say no. I would say that clarinervium is more terrestrial, so it can tolerate more soil, but otherwise they're pretty similar in my opinion. And how do you propagate your queen without killing it? I do have a video where I recently propagate a queen by propagating her stem. If you watch my how to stem propagate video, I will go ahead and link that. But as for propagating it like directly from her stems here on the plant, it's honestly not something I've done yet. If I did plan to do it, I would certainly wait until I had at least some roots on the stem. I wouldn't just directly go chopping because these are my babies and I'm not touching them unless the circumstances are good for it. And then the last questions. I love these. Are you a wizard? No, I am not a wizard. I prefer the term witch, but thank you for asking. Did it require a blood sacrifice? Not from what I could recall, but I wouldn't doubt it if they stole my blood without me looking. I mean, they are queens, so do what they want. Have you signed a pact with the devil? Not from my recollection, but I'll throw up this velvet flashlight party picture that I took with Chris. So we started doing this thing where we go into my plant room at night with a flashlight and take some photos. And Anastasia certainly looks like she has a little bit of a devil in her because her shadow is kind of freaky in this photo, but I think it's really cool. So yeah. That's pretty much that. So that's the end of this video. I honestly hope this was genuinely helpful for you. I get so many questions about queen anthuriums, and honestly, I just want to end this with saying they're not as complicated as you might think. There's just so many reasons they're set up for failure. And honestly, before you get one, just be prepared. Do your research. You know, this video pretty much covers the topics, so if you follow it, you should be golden. So just remember that moisture is really the most important thing for them. And as long as you got that locked down, then you should be good. It's weird because they have such a reputation for being so difficult, but it is genuinely surprising how well they do in my household. Like 55% humidity really doesn't feel like a crazy amount, but honestly, I don't find them super difficult at all. And I have imported quite a few as well as received them from within my own country, and I haven't had any issues with those. So the takeaway is don't get her during winter time. Make sure to keep her properly hydrated, and honestly, you're pretty much set. So if you have any other questions, please let me know down below. I really appreciate you watching this video. I hope you really did enjoy it, and thank you so much. Girl, why are you saying?